Have you ever felt like the Walking Dead? Have you ever felt like you're just wandering around aimlessly through life, pursuing these appetites that these chemicals in your brain tell you that you need to follow this, you need to consume this, you need to do this, and you do it without really having any feeling at all? It's just kind of like, I do this without any feeling, without any purpose, without any hope. I can remember coming to a place like that in my junior year of high school. This is actually not, this was not a good time for me. I was completely overloaded with homework. My family life was not the best, not the way I wanted it to be. My love life was awful. And I just felt terrible about life in general. Just completely dead inside. And late one night, I remember thinking, I was there, I think, studying for like AP Bio or something like that. And maybe you've had this experience where you just start thinking, is it really worth it all? Do I really want to continue living? And I say that kind of humorously, but the reality was that I was really down in the dumps. And I really thought, should my life actually go on? Should I keep doing this? It's just, I feel like I'm just the walking dead. I'm like this zombie just wandering through life and doing these things and just feeling like I don't want to do it anymore. Maybe you felt that way. And if you have, you're not alone. You're not alone. A lot of people are walking around in the exact same boat. They're not really sure what they're supposed to be doing. They're wandering around trying any new thing that they think will make them feel some sense of being alive, even if it only affects them temporarily. And eventually they start asking themselves, why go on? Why go on? I've tried this, I've tried that, I've tried all these different things that people say I should have in my life, and it's not really making a difference. Tonight is all about coming to the realization that it does not have to, nor should it be that way. Shouldn't be that way. My prayer is that you and I would be completely blown away and stoked as we unpack the mystery of God's plan for our lives and His goodness towards us. We're going to start off by looking at Ezekiel chapter 37. And we'll start in verse 1. Ezekiel chapter 37, if you do have Bibles. Ezekiel 37 verse 1 says this. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and He brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. This is Ezekiel talking. He says, it was full of bones. It was full of bones. And He led me around among them, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry. And He said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, You know. Pretty good answer. Then He said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord. He says, say that. Say that to these bones. So what did Ezekiel do? Verse 7. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a sound. And behold, a rattling. Clink, 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 all over the valley. And the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, there were sinews on them, and the flesh had come upon them, and the skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then He said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied, as He commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and they stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. What a weird story, right? What a weird thing it must have been to be there and to see these bones start rattling and start coming together. You see the skull rolling along and then it pops onto the spinal cord and all it was like, whoa, there's a full skeleton there. And then it starts like all the stuff starts covering and then it's skin and you're just like, whoa, this is crazy. Gruesome, but awesome. The power of God to take something that's utterly lifeless. Notice he said these bones were dry. Utterly lifeless and make it alive again. Bring it back from the dead. The Bible points to a fundamental problem that's common to everyone, every member of the human race. It's this. We're all dead. We're all dead. Our passage tonight is actually Ephesians chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 1. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. It says this. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by very nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. You were dead. I was dead. But what does that mean? I mean, obviously, we're all walking around. It looks like we all had three meals today, maybe two and a half, a snack. Some of you guys tried that apple dip out there that was so good, and you enjoyed it. It's proof. You're alive. You're living. So what are you talking about, Jared? I think I'm alive. No, you're not. You're dead. Or at least you were at one point. Paul's saying you were spiritually dead. You were spiritually dead. As far as your relationship to God is concerned, you were dead. There was a point when you had no inclination, no responsiveness, no ability whatsoever to please God. You didn't have it. And not only that, you were dead to experiencing the marvelous things that God created you to experience from the very beginning. You were dead to that. You were cut off from the peace that comes from confidently trusting in the goodness of God. You were cut off from experiencing the joy that comes from being close to the most beautiful, the most exciting, the most powerful, the most knowledgeable, awe-inspiring, loving, perfect being in all existence. You were cut off from that. I never had a close relationship with my grandparents. They're all dead now. Never had a close relationship with them. I knew who they were. They knew who I was. Spent a little bit of time with them. But I never really felt like they cared much about me or knew what was going on in my life. And as a result, when each one of them passed away, I was like, I know I should be feeling something right now, but I don't really feel anything. Is that sad? I think so. I think that's really sad. But you know, there are some people who are absolutely crushed when a grandparent dies. They can barely take it because they experienced that special bond with their grandparents, and they felt this overwhelming sense of loss because they know that they'll never have that again with their grandparents. That's the way we would feel if we had known what our rebellion against God cost us, what we lost from it, if we knew what we were losing, we would just be crushed. And that's the agony that Jesus experienced on the cross. A lot of people think, man, when they put those nails in Jesus and they put the spear in his side and he's hanging up there and the bugs are flying around and the birds are pecking at him, you think utter agony. But the real agony for Jesus was when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? When he took upon himself all of our sin and God turns away for the very first time. See, Jesus, from all eternity, he was God. And he had this perfect fellowship, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. They had this incredible relationship and together they were complete. And to experience the loss of that for the first time, it was brutal. It was brutal. One pastor wrote, "All lost sinners are dead. The only difference between one sinner and another is the state of decay. The lost derelict on Skid Row may be more decayed outwardly than the unsaved society leader, but both are dead in sin, and one corpse cannot be more dead than another." You don't have various levels of dead. You're dead. That's it. I mean, your body might, you know, like, maybe it's, your skin is gone. Okay, all right. Oh, the worms are just starting to eat you. Okay. But you're all dead. It doesn't matter. Question is, how'd you get there? How'd you get there? The answer is this. You got there. We got there. By doing what everyone else did. By living out the desires of our hearts that were rebellious towards God. Paul calls us the sons of disobedience and says, we all once lived in the passions of our flesh. And when he says flesh, he's not talking about our physical bodies here. He's not talking about the flesh and bones. The body that was created by God, it's not bad. It's been affected by sin, but it's not evil in and of itself. Not evil. The flesh, on the other hand, the flesh that he's talking about, he's describing our corrupt nature. God gave us a nature that was pure and holy, and it was corrupted by sin. We were made in the image of God, initially bent towards worshiping him, serving him, glorifying him, looking to him for our pleasure and joy alone. And then when we sinned, all of that started to change. The direction of our hearts changed. That's what changed. Instead of looking up, we started looking in and looking out all around. Where are we going to be satisfied? Not in God anymore. We're going to be satisfied here. We're going to be satisfied out there. And we were in rebellion against God. The passions of our flesh, he speaks of, are the desires of the corrupt human heart. In this rebellious turn, it earned us death, according to Romans 6:23. That's sad. What a miserable place to be dead. To be turned away from God and separated from all his goodness. But the amazing thing here is, did you notice this? If you have your Bibles, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. Just the first few words here. He says, and you were dead. Thank you, Paul. Thank you for saying that. Isn't it great? The past tense. Isn't it beautiful? Oh, I love you, past tense. Thank you for being here. I was dead. Not anymore. Not anymore. I'm alive now. Look at verse 4. He says this, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. By God's goodness, you have been saved. It was all him, and he made you alive. Oh, it's so good. He raised us up with him, seated us with him in the heavenly places, so that in the coming ages, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. You are alive. You are alive. There are three places in the gospel where Jesus raised people back to life. In Luke 7, verse 11, the widow's son, Jesus raises back to life. In Luke 8, verse 49, he raises Jairus' daughter. In John 11, 41, he raises Lazarus. That's probably the one everyone remembers. Lazarus coming out of the tomb. Each time Jesus speaks, he speaks the word, and dead people respond. And it was the word that brought to life those dry bones, wasn't it? It was speaking the word of God to those dry bones. And these are all pictures for us of the spiritual resurrection that comes to dead sinners when they hear and believe God's word. Jesus said in John 5:24, he said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life." I love that because it's certain, it's definite. Whoever hears it, whoever believes it, eternal life. I have to hold on to that with both hands. I don't want to let go of that because it's a promise. He doesn't come into judgment. That's really good. But he's passed from death to life. You know, it's one thing to be raised physically from the dead. That's one thing. You know, because when you're, I mean, think of Lazarus. He came out of the tomb. He's got all the wrappings on. He starts peeling them off and then realizes he doesn't, whoa, I need to put some clothes on. But he's excited that he's alive again. Yeah, and you know, his family that was just weeping, now they're just laughing and jumping up and down. I don't know if they're holding hands in a circle and like bouncing around or what, but they're happy. They're super excited. But you know, Lazarus eventually died. He's not walking around today, you know, doing like tours and say, hey, I was the guy. I was the guy Jesus raised from the dead. Look at me. I'm still here. No, he died. It's one thing to be raised physically, but you still eventually die. But to be raised spiritually is a completely different thing. Spiritual resurrection, it's not like that. It's not a second chance. In fact, there's no chance involved at all. It's so much better when you've been spiritually resurrected. You can never die again. And this is super important. So important for you to hold on to. Because sometimes I think there is temptation for us to think, we came to Jesus, I asked forgiveness for my sins, he made me a new creation, yes, but I think I'm dying again. I think I messed up my chance. I think I'm no good now. I crossed certain lines that I thought I would never cross, that my parents told me, don't ever cross that, you'll be kicked out of the house. I crossed some of those lines. Maybe you have. And you're feeling like you're at the very edge of death. Don't believe it. Don't believe it because your new life has nothing to do with your good deeds or your bad deeds. Nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with what Jesus did. And guess what? Jesus isn't undoing what he did. He's not going back to the cross, flying back in time and saying, nah, I don't think I'll go through this, and like jumps off the cross and starts whoosh, whoosh, beating people up. That didn't happen. It's not going to happen. He did it. It's done. But get this, the righteousness that Jesus has that was passed to you, that was imputed to you, that was placed on you, that doesn't go away either. Jesus isn't all of a sudden going to be like, yeah, I think, you know, I've been good up to this point, but I think I'm going to sin now a little bit. And you're like, no, Jesus, my righteousness is going away from me. And you're like, turning back into the dry bones, you know, kind of like the Indiana Jones thing where he drinks the cup and he's like, ah. That doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. What Christ did, he did for good. It's final. It's not going to change. What a relief that is. Not to live in fear that someday you might mess up just a little too much and blow this whole gig. But the new life that you have, that's not the only thing that you get. It's not the only thing that you get. Paul says, you're sitting in a place of honor. Sitting in a place of honor. Look at verse 6 again. He says this, and raised us up. This is what Christ did. This is what God did with through Christ. He raised us up with him, with Christ, seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Can you imagine what a terrible thing it would be to be raised back to life? And then you're trapped in the coffin. Can you imagine? I mean, talk about a horror story. You know, I'm sure there's shows. I know there's shows out there about being buried alive. And, you know, you wake up and you're like, no, I'm trapped. I'm alive, but I'm going to die. What a terrible thing it would be like. And, you know, and so what do you do with your time? You know, you're sitting in there, you're laying in there in the coffin. You're just like, well, I'm glad I'm alive, but probably don't have much time. What am I going to do? Well, I'd play solitaire, but I don't have any cards. You know, what a bummer, right? And it's like, hey, I'm alive again. Oh no, this stinks, right? It'd be terrible. And yet, I think some people feel that way. They come back to life in Christ, and then they think that, oh, I've just got this miserable life here. What do I have? And Paul says, no way, man. Do you realize what you've got? You've been elevated to this position, this incredible position of honor and glory and authority and great wealth that you share with Christ. I mean, Jesus shares in everything with the Father and the Spirit, and we're brought up right into that circle with Him. This is amazing. You're seated in a place of honor. That's the place that Paul tells us God will show us the immeasurable riches. That immeasurable word is important, isn't it? Because when something's immeasurable, it means you can't measure it. Have you ever had one of those cheap tape measures? You know, you get it from like the bank or something like that, and you're like, oh yes, I found a tape measure. And you go to measure something, and you're like, what can I do with this? But even the longest tape measure you could ever have is not going to be long enough to measure the pile of riches that you have in Christ Jesus. You can't measure it. It's awesome. It's awesome. Warren Wiersbe writes, what a miracle of God's grace. We are taken out of the great graveyard of sin and placed in the throne room of glory. Some of you right now are saying, I don't feel like I'm placed in the throne room of glory. These clothes I'm wearing, you know, they're ready for the goodwill. I don't have the iPhone 6. I don't feel very glorious right now. I cut my own hair. I couldn't afford to take a bath today. Maybe you're not feeling very glorious. Yet, let me tell you, you are seated in glory. People who lived in Ephesus were fascinated by magic. They were fascinated by the occult. We're reading Ephesians here. People who lived there, they were fascinated by all this stuff. They were captivated with trying to figure out how they were going to overcome things, how they were going to overcome obstacles in life, how they were going to become wealthy. And so people today, you know, they go to self-help seminars and they go to school and they do all these different things to try to get wealth, try to make their lives count. They'll go to fitness clinics, try to get super healthy. You know, they'll drink those nasty shakes. They'll do whatever they organic. Give me a break. You know, they're doing all this stuff to try and make their lives better. We want bigger cars, right? We want bigger houses. We want hotter boyfriends and girlfriends. We want more money. We want more power. We want more fame. We want better looks. We want firmer abs. We want darker tans. We want hotter clothes. We want, and we're striving to get it. The list could go on. The sad thing is that it's never ending. It's totally exhausting. And it's absolutely unfulfilling. You can get all these things and it's just not quite enough. And to people who are striving like that, Paul has some really good news. People in Orange County who just can't, they just want more. He says, you know what, I have some really good news for you. In fact, I think it's incredible news for you. Guess what, guys? You've been made alive in Christ. You're seated in heavenly places, destined to get all that God has to offer for ages and ages into eternity. Do you know that's your future? Is that exciting or what? Paul's talking about the best Christmas ever. It's a Christmas that never ends. It never ends. It doesn't get any sweeter than that. So be excited. You have a new life in Christ. And a final thing, that having this new identity with Christ and being changed, being made alive with Christ does. It makes you God's workmanship. You are God's workmanship. He says, verse 10, we're His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You've been intentionally created You were created on purpose. The little details that make you who you are, the little freckles that are in certain places, and the weird thing your nose does when you sneeze and it crinkles up, and you know, maybe you can like whittle your ears or something. All the things about you, and beyond the physical stuff, your personality and your intelligence and all of that, your humor, all of that has been made unique for a reason. But it's not just about who you were born to be. Not just about who you were born to be. People use that as an excuse all the time. They say, well, I was born that way. That's who I am. I am who I am, and I'm not going to change, right? And they say, well, you know, so I'm not going to change. I'm not going to change my behavior. I'm not going to change my shortcomings in life. I am who I am. It's just who I was born to be. But the fact is, those who have been raised with Christ are new creations. They're new creations. God's continually working in them, shaping them to look more and more like Jesus. More and more like Jesus. And this is done by the power of God's Holy Spirit working in you. Your ability to live in a way that pleases God, it's not limited by who you were born to be. That's important. Not limited by who you were born to be. If it was, we would look less like resurrected, Christ-filled sons and daughters of the King, and more like those gruesome characters known as the Walking Dead. We'd be raised up, and we'd just be walking around like every other dead person out there, smelling up a storm, dripping stuff all over the place. It's disgusting. They moved around, but they produced nothing but horrific results. But that's not you. It's not you. Paul says in Philippians 2:13, he says, it's God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. God is working inside of you to change you. We can't just say, I was born that way. This is just who I am. I'm not going to change. I can't change. The reality is, being raised with Christ and his, it means having his Spirit working within us. And that should compel us to say, I was born that way, but God's Spirit is working in me to change me, to enable me to be more. And you know, there are times I mess up. I mess up all the time. And I have to come to people and I have to say, you know, I am so sorry. I really blew it there. I really made a huge mistake. Please forgive me. And know that God's working in me to change me, to make me more than I am. You are more. You're God's workmanship. Though you were once spiritually dead, now you're alive and empowered to fulfill God's purpose, a purpose greater than returning to Gotham to fight crime. I love that scene in that Batman movie where Bruce Wayne, he just bought like a hotel building and he's walking out and he gets into his Lamborghini and he sees, I think it's Rachel there, and he sees Rachel and she's like judging him or something like that. And he's like, but wait, Rachel, I am more, right? You are more now. You've been created in Christ Jesus to bring God glory. I'll close with this. Matthew 5:14, Jesus says, you are the light of the world. City set on a hill, it can't be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp, put it under a basket. That doesn't make sense. But on a stand, it gives light to all in the house. He says, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. I ask you just to close your eyes and bow your heads and just think about yourself and possibly, maybe you might fit into one of these three categories here. You're still a heap of bones lying on the floor. Still being kicked around with the dust that blows every which way, and you're not sure if you really know Jesus. you've made that transition from death to life. If you're not sure, you can't be sure. And you come to God and you say, God, I need you. I know I've messed up. I know I've rebelled against you. I know I'm a sinner. I know what that means. And I know I can't save myself. Thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die on a cross for me. Die in my place that I might live. Transform me, God. Make me new. Breathe life into me again. Maybe you're one of those who has been made alive, but you really don't live in the reality that you've been seated with Christ in heavenly places. You find yourself continually discouraged and just weighed down by all the junk that's going on around you, not realizing that you have a place of honor and authority. You have riches to look forward to with Christ. Maybe tonight you need a change of perspective and you need to be reminded that you are a child of the King with all the rights and privileges. Maybe you're someone who says, I am who I am and nothing is going to change that, and you've been trusting in your own abilities rather than God's Spirit who's working in you. You don't realize that God has not only given you a purpose, but that He has equipped you to joyfully fulfill that purpose. That it's actually an exciting thing to say, God, thank you that you are at work within me, transform me. What do you have for me? What am I on this earth for? How do you want to use me? How have you created me uniquely, and how are you changing me to prepare me for the work that you have for me? And what is the work that you have for me right now? I think so often in high school and junior high and college, we get so fixated on preparing that we forget that God's equipped us right now and wants to use us where He has placed us for His glory. Know this: God loves you. He sent His Son Jesus Christ to die on a cross that you might be made alive, that you might be given a position of royalty and empowered to serve the King. If you placed your trust in Christ, you were not the walking dead. You were sons and daughters of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Lord, we thank you. We thank you. You didn't just give us a second chance. You made us alive, and our life depends on Jesus Christ. It's secure, and we can have confidence in that. And Lord, you have seated us in heavenly places. Lord, that is where we belong. That's where our citizenship is. And we're only here temporarily, and we're looking forward, longing for the day when we'll see you face to face, be with you. And Lord, not only that, we're your workmanship, and you've prepared us to do things here. Lord, show us what you have for us. Show us those people around us who need to hear the good news, and give us the boldness and the confidence and the tact even to share your truth with them in a loving way. And for those who are hurting around us, Lord, more than ever, people in our world are suffering. Show us how we might have a part in serving them and ministering to them and pointing them to the fact that you are real and you are good. Lord, we love you. Everything we have, it's because of you. So we thank you and we worship you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.